Chapter 31. My dad and I are sitting on the couch. I was an infantry replacement in World War II, he tells me. Do you know what that is? He's told me this story many times before, but I don't stop him. That's cannon fodder, he says. When soldiers got killed up in the front lines, they moved the next batch right in. When I saw what was happening, I never really expected to come home alive. It dawns on me that although I have heard this story before, maybe I haven't really heard it at all. We were finishing basic training, and my psoriasis was acting up. I don't know, I just didn't feel like training that day. I took myself over to see the doctor. He examined me, and we talked about it a while. There really wasn't much he could do about the psoriasis. I was getting ready to leave. I was almost out the door. I turned back to the doctor and said, "Oh yeah, one other thing, Doc. I've been having this rectal bleeding the past couple of days." I wasn't even going to mention it. You know, it was kind of embarrassing and all that. I don't know what made me finally tell him. Well, right away, the doctor brings me back in and does a thorough examination. He discovers I have colitis and sends me straight to the hospital. The next day, my platoon gets called to the front lines. The next day, they all got killed in Italy. Every one of them. I'm telling you, Howie, so you'll understand how life works. If I hadn't mentioned that to the doctor, I wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be here. You'd have never been born. Chapter 32. At 2 p.m. that day, when the hospital hasn't called, my dad and I are getting pretty nervous. I still can't escape from nauseating pork burps, and we are both trying real hard not to unravel. You know, my dad says as he hears the cuckoo clock cuckoo 8 times, he knows it means 2 o'clock. He has long since figured out the formula. This is getting pretty hard for me to sit here. His voice is soft and measured, but in my blood, I know he is as close to a terrified scream as my father ever wants to get. Well, I know we have the phone number of thoracic recovery, so I say, why don't we call them? And so we do. They know that patient Adeline Gordon's son is a doctor, so they start reporting to me in medical terms. After she just came out of surgery and she's in stable condition, it all starts to sound like a foreign language to me. You have the wrong son, I tell them. I'm not the doctor. I understand that Dr. Gordon was supposed to be called when our mother came out of surgery, so why don't you do that now and give him the full medical report? I'll have the nurse call as soon as she can, the doctor says. We hang up. Dad, Mom's out of surgery now. She just came out. She's stable, and the doctors all say the operation went well. They're going to call Jerry and give him the full story. Happy tears. My dad stands up and embraces me. God, it feels good. The 10,000 fingers that have been slowly strangling both of us loosen their grip. We stand there hugging for an eternity. We had decided earlier that if all went well, we would have a drink and give our thanks. I call Jerry. He's working on a medical paper at his home. I tell him that Mom is out of surgery, stable, and they will be calling him shortly. He, too, is relieved. We hang right up. True to the plan, my dad pulls out some Ketum sweet wine and struggles with his failing eyes to pour us 2 glasses. Some of the wine is spilled on the counter. We couldn't care less. A euphoria sets in. I didn't know this morning, Dad says, if we'd be going back to the hospital or to Ralph Sugar's funeral home. He is buoyant. It is a treasure to see my father's love for my mother. After all these years and the twists and turns of their life together, we raise our glasses. I suggest we intertwine our arms, Russian style, in the spirit of his ancestors. And we do. We toast to Mother, Dr. Mashiraju, Bill Mazeroski, and everybody else we can remember, and we drink. Selah, which is a Hebrew word, especially from the biblical book of Psalms, signifying the end of one paragraph and a pause before the next. Jerry calls soon after and explains, oh my God, he's using medical language too. Jerry, I interrupt him, I'm not a doctor, just give me the headlines, in English. Triple bypass and a valve repair, he says to me. It was a major piece of work, but they're all happy with the results. I go to the Jewish Community Center and play racquetball. I pick up Dad afterwards and we go out to dinner with Aunt Kitty. Later, my dad and I fall into a conversation about Jesus and Jews and the world and the life and death of all those secret and not so secret aspects of the human condition that a father and son can only share with each other after they have survived an ordeal by fire. We don't get to bed till around 3 in the morning. Chapter 33. By our senior year of high school, Harold and David had expanded their duet into a trio to include me. We thought we were pretty hot shit. David had become the school's student council president, and I got elected senior class president, and Harold became our self-appointed conscience. David and I shared him as a prime minister. We each boasted popular girlfriends, each other, and had high school by the balls, or so we thought. David was the trio's conservative. He always seemed to have too much homework when the imaginative Harold concocted some new adventure for us to try. Closer to Harold's point of view than to David's, I was somewhere in between. I served as a lighter anchor than David for Harold's flights of fancy. I was also a lever to help occasionally pry David loose from his books. We never did anything too wild. We were still good boys. We all graduated high school as non-drinking, non-smoking virgins. Drugs were still non-existent in our neighborhood. As the year passed, Harold and I became more bonded in search of creating adventure. We dreamed of ocean voyages and foreign travel. We thought we'd become screenwriters and actors and take over Hollywood. In the spring of our senior year, we cut a week of school and decided to hitchhike from Pittsburgh to East Lansing, Michigan, where we had an invitation to party at Michigan State. This was heavy-duty excitement. We hung around the fraternity scene and got a good taste of the college life we thought would be ours shortly. We thought it was all going to be football games and keg parties and girls. Yeah, girls. Little did we imagine that the 60s were about to explode all over the country, and our lives with them. While we were on campus, Harold badly sprained an ankle playing in a pickup basketball game. It was all purple, swollen, and ugly. We had no money for the crutches that the student infirmary tried to sell us. We had to make it back to Pittsburgh without them. I spent a great deal of that return journey carrying my friend Harold piggyback. From my perspective, it took forever. We started hitchhiking early in the morning and were still sticking out our thumbs deep into the night. It was already illegal to hitchhike on the new interstate freeways where many of our rides had dropped us off. Several times, I had to carry Harold down off the freeway, across one of those highway fields, and over to the next on-ramp. From there, we would resume the uncertain business of hitching the next ride. Those fields are surprisingly bigger than they look when you drive by them in a car. They were cold and muddy with thawing snow and icy water on that early spring day. In one of them, I sank ankle deep into the cold bog, and I had Harold on my back laughing at me. It pissed me off. To cool his unwelcome good humor, I tried dropping him into the shallow ooze. That son of a bitch held on tight and pulled me down with him. We splashed into the muck together. Sitting there in the wet, cold slime of our first real freedom, we pointed at each other and started laughing. We sat there laughing forever. Maybe we're still there. Chapter 34. The visiting hours at Thoracic Recovery, 11 to 11:30 a.m. in the morning, 2:30 to 3 p.m. in the afternoon, and 8:30 to 9 p.m. at night. We catch the late show on the first night, or maybe it was the early show the next morning. It reminds me of when Carly and I had our babies. Parking lots, hospitals, sleeplessness, and schedules, who knows? You just have to pace yourself and keep on going. Both my brother and my father cautioned me heavily before seeing Mother in the intensive care unit. They are afraid that I will freak out when I see her plugged into all the machines like a never-ready battery. It takes me back 30 years to Zadie's funeral. Mom and Dad sat me down before entering the funeral home to explain what Zadie would look like. Said he was sleeping. He sure was, only he was kind of green. My mother has 200 tubes in her, attached to a whole wall of a computer console that looks like a machine giving her a smog check. Her face is swollen, and the tubes are running out of her nose and mouth. She reminds me of Charles Laughton in The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Jerry explains the normal recovery from the procedures Mom has undergone are similar to those encountered in recovering from being hit by a truck. My daddy loves her. My brother loves her. And I love her. At 11:30, at 2:30, and again at 8:30. The nurses come and go. The doctors come and go. And we come and go. It is one long walk in the fog of hospital corridors, Pittsburgh streets, in light and dark, restaurants, parking spaces, and alarm clocks. There are tears in my mom's eyes when she first recognizes us. She can't talk. I pet her forehead. There's so much to say. A respirator is breathing her. The tubes, the wires, the beeps, the pads, the swellings, the bandages, and different colored liquid-filled bags are hanging everywhere. Mama's a Christmas tree, all decorated with intensive care ornaments. Chapter 35. Aunt Kitty is taking us out for Chinese food. A bunch of police in brightly lettered narcotics squad jackets come and sit down at the table next to us. I can't help flinching when they first walk in. Force of habit. I used to smoke a lot of pot when it was illegal. After eating, it's time for the fortune cookies. Aunt Kitty reads hers. Keep your face to the sunshine and you will never see the shadows. Mine says, adventure can be real happiness. What does yours say, Dad? Where is it? He asks me. It's in your cookie. Where's your cookie? I ate it. Chapter 36. This conversation happened 1,214 times. I would come home and say, hey, Iz, did I get any phone calls? Izzy would answer, yeah, somebody called. Call him back. Who was it, Iz? Who called? Uh-oh. Izzy would go blank. He had no idea. Who called, Iz? Who was it? I don't know, he would say, getting irritated. Some guy. Call him back. Izzy, I can't call him back if I don't know who it is. At that point, Izzy would make a noise which defies translation, but I would persist. Izzy, who called? Ah! This interrogation could go on for a while. It would invariably end with Izzy saying, well, then he would make a noise again. You can't really spell this noise. You can't really write it. But it'd be a sound that indicated Izzy didn't remember who called, or that he never really knew who called, and that he would never be able to tell you who called. And he was getting pretty irritated talking about it. He'd finally say, ah, forget about it. It was the wrong number.